170, Rousey versus McMahon, presented by Bud Light. Here we go. Tonight's SAP is brought to you by UFCEspanol.com. Tonight's broadcast is available in 100% Spanish. Let's get things started. Hi, everybody. I'm Mike Goldberg. Welcome once again to the Ultimate Fighting Championship. With the Olympics going on in Sochi tonight, we have an Olympic flavor inside the octagon. In UFC history, 7 Olympic medalists, 11 Olympians in all, have competed. But never before have we had 2 medalists fight each other. Well, not until tonight. And those 2 medalists are the best in the world at 135 in the women's division. Our main event, Ronda Rousey, Sarah McMahon. Wow, what a matchup.
It's an excellent matchup and a huge honor for the UFC to have 2 Olympic medalists and a huge feather in the cap of the women that they're the ones who pulled it off. Ronda Rousey is the best representative of judo we have ever seen in mixed martial arts. She also has, in my opinion, the best arm bars in all of mixed martial arts. She has been nothing short of spectacular. But Sarah McMahon is a real threat to her title. She has incredible wrestling technique. She's very physically strong, and she knows how to win. We go,
ladies and gentlemen. Yesterday at the weigh-in, Sarah McMahon, 7-0, made weight easily. She's a professional. Ronda Rousey, not a lot of talk back and forth like Misha Tate. In fact, Sarah is a pretty quiet, reserved, silent assassin.
She said she wants Ronda to do all the talking, let Ronda sell the fight, and she wants to win it. She's concentrating completely on getting into the octagon tonight and stopping Ronda Rousey in all areas of her game.
All right, for weeks, Daniel Cormier, the 2-time Olympian, has been concentrating on one thing and one thing only, fighting for the first time at 205 pounds. 10 days ago, he lost his opponent. Rashad Evans blew out his knee. So enter Patrick Cummins, 2-time All-American, 2-time national team member, who said he has made Daniel Cormier cry in the wrestling room before.
I don't know about all that. I wasn't there. What happens in the wrestling room stays in the wrestling
room. Which is what Daniel said should have happened.
What I do know is that Daniel Cormier is a stud. He's an outstanding wrestler, and he has been incredibly successful as a heavyweight against 2 heavyweight champions. He beat both Josh Barnett and Frank Mir, knocked out Bigfoot Silva. He's been outstanding. Pat Cummins is a man who has been so dominant in his MMA career that 40 different opponents have canceled fights on him. That's not a coincidence. It's because they've seen this man train. He is a beast in the gym. The question is whether or not he can pull off a victory on short notice against a man like Daniel Cormier.
Well, as you saw, an emotional Daniel Cormier. He said, all right, now you're in my kitchen. Now you're putting me down. You're saying you made me cry. You know what? Nobody talks about the wrestling room. This is personal.
Well, listen, this is how Pat Cummins got this fight. There's only one way for Pat Cummins to get this fight. He had to talk. He had to get Daniel Cormier excited enough to take the fight. He had to get Dana White excited enough to sign him. He did that. Let's see tonight if he can walk the walk.
He had to talk on his cell phone at his job at the coffee shop. He got fired, but you know what? He's in the UFC now, so bye-bye coffee shop. Hello, Octagon. Also tonight, 2 of the best at 170 pounds.
In the welterweight division, UFC and MMA veteran Mike Pyle looks to earn his 22nd career victory as he fights TJ Wahlberger. Also at 170, Rory McDonald looks to reignite his ascension to the top of the welterweight division by taking out the 5-time Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu world champion, Damian Maia. Our rules of the octagon, 3 judges score the bout duration, 3 5-minute rounds. Tonight's championship fight is scheduled for 5 5-minute rounds. A 10-point must scoring system is in effect, with the round winner gaining 10 points, his opponent 9 or less, based on effective striking, grappling, aggression, and octagon control. Tonight's UFC 170 is presented in high definition. Great night of fights in store for you. And we begin with the Karate Kids. Stephen Thompson loves to utilize his superior striking skills to smash opponents. But tonight, he takes on fellow Karate Black Belt, Robert Whittaker. It's one of the most intriguing matchups of the new year, as dynamic striking specialist Stephen Thompson faces off with former Ultimate Fighter Smashes winner Robert Whittaker in a clash of welterweight bangers.
You know, I feel this fight could only go one way, and that's with a knockout. And, you know, my goal is to get in there and just keep hitting him until he goes down.
He's a strong dude, man. I mean, he's got one shot, one knockout power, but I'm ready for it.
A decorated kickboxer whose MMA career has seen him pick up UFC knockouts of Dan Stitchkin and Chris Clements, as well as an impressive decision win over Nishan Burrell, Stephen Thompson plans on unleashing more highlight reel maneuvers tonight.
I want to go out there, you know, lay it all out on the line, and hopefully there's a good knockout. We'll see. But like I said, I'm just going to go out there and do my thing.
Australia's Robert Whittaker is no stranger to the flashy finish either, having scored big wins on the smashes and against fellow Ultimate Fighter winner Colton Smith. Now it's time to see whether it's Thompson or Whittaker whose chin is up to the task in the octagon.
I'm going to take it to him.
Bud Light, here we go. New Zealand's Whittaker, just 23 years old. South Carolina's Thompson, 31. Stephen Thompson will have a slight reach advantage. And to get things officially underway, here is Bruce Buffer.
Ladies and gentlemen, we are live from the Mandalay Bay Resort and Casino in Las Vegas for UFC 170, presented by Bud Light. Here we go. And now, this fight is 3 rounds in the UFC welterweight division. Introducing first, fighting out of the blue corner, a mixed martial artist holding a professional record, 8 wins, 1 loss. He stands 6 feet tall, weighing in at 171 pounds. Fighting out of Simpsonville, South Carolina, Stephen Wonderboy Thompson. And now introducing his opponent, fighting out of the red corner, a mixed martial artist holding a professional record, 12 wins, 3 losses, standing 6 feet tall, weighing in at 170 pounds, fighting out of Sydney, Australia, Robert Whittaker! And when the action begins, our referee in charge, Mario Yamasaki.
Mario Yamasaki, our referee. Great battle to get things started.
Here we go, first round, you ready? You ready? Let's go, come on.
Set to go. Tonight's clock brought to you by Bud Light. Here we go. That side stance of Stephen Thompson early. Oh, good jab by Whittaker. Whittaker, the tough smashes winner.
So Thompson uses that side stance and that front leg technique quite often. And it's also very, very good at switching techniques, switching stances. There's a nice inside leg kick, and he goes high.
Whittaker answers. Whittaker has very powerful combinations.
Good combination so far from both men. But I'm really liking the kicks, Thompson.
I like how he leaned back, Lyoto Machida style.
Well, he's really fighting karate style, his hands down, yep. Side stance. He's moving back well, though. Nice kick to the body off that front leg, and a nice leg kick as well.
Stutter step.
And he's getting off court first.
He's mixing his timing up very well.
Pressure, Robert, pressure on the inside. Stay on the pocket.
Turns the corner and he's gone.
He's got him thinking. Front leg axe kick to the face of Whitaker.
Now, he had that great start to his UFC career with this knockout of Dan Stinchin.
But what we're seeing from Thompson is what we've seen from him in his kickboxing career. It's just, it took a while for him to get comfortable enough with his takedown defense and all the other aspects of mixed martial arts to see what he's really capable of inside the octagon. Because, you know, as George St. Pierre said, his striking is just on a totally different level than most fighters that compete in MMA.
Whitaker trying to chase him down.
Look at that beautiful head movement.
Absolutely.
Feet together, hands and feet.
It's just a slip and a rip.
Okay.
Whitaker trying to turn up the pace now.
Yeah, Whitaker's trying to find him. He's landed a few good jabs. But for the most part, Thompson has not been there when those combinations start flying towards him.
When you see 1, 2, 3, 4, that's when you know a fighter is really putting together some nice work, and that's what Thompson's been doing.
There's that front leg side kick to the body, too, which makes you think twice about moving forward. He went with a hook kick to the head there. Bill Superfoot Wallace style. Shout out to UFC 1. Nice straight left and a right hand behind it.
Whitaker looking to establish the jab.
The movement of Thompson is excellent. He's sliding back slightly and then coming in with shots of his own. And he's putting Whitaker in a shell when he does that.
Come in, baby.
Good, Robin. Whitaker scored two big knockouts on his way to becoming the Ultimate Fighter Smash's winner. And Thompson at high volume thus far.
But Thompson is certainly the one who's mixing his techniques up more here.
Yes!
That's there's a nice jab.
He's hurt.
Whitaker's in big trouble.
Yep. And again, he connects.
He's hurt bad.
Looking to finish a fight. Can he do it here? Mario Yamasaki is over.
That's it.
It is all over.
Big win for Stephen Thompson.
Finishes Robert Whitaker. Wow.
And that is the Stephen Thompson that we saw in his kickboxing career. It's amazing that this kid decided to get into MMA and work through all the difficulties involved in transitioning from being a kickboxer to being a mixed martial arts fighter. But we're seeing it all come into focus now.
Our fight replay brought to you by Bud Light. Here we go.
And this is what has always made Stephen Thompson so special. His ability to move in and out. His ability to snake-like land these combinations. Slide back, 1, 2, boom, right hand on the button. And even you see as he lands that right hand, he's moving away from potential counters. He sees Whitaker go down and he swarms on him. And here Whitaker's grabbing a hold of that leg, but Thompson is just all over him, and Mario Yamasaki rescues him.
Outstanding performance by Stephen Thompson. As he finishes Robert Whitaker in the very first round. Here is Bruce Buffer.
Ladies and gentlemen, referee Mario Yamasaki has called a stop to this contest at 3 minutes, 43 seconds of the very first round. Declaring the winner by TKO, Stephen Wonderboy Thompson.
It's as good as he has looked inside the octagon.
How are you doing, sir?
And against a very good opponent.
I am here with the winner, Stephen Thompson. Wow. First of all, congratulations on a victory over a very talented striker in Robert Whitaker. But you just looked on fire tonight. As we see your MMA career progress, you really are getting much more comfortable inside the octagon, and we're seeing what we saw in your kickboxing career.
Yeah, you know, I mean, the more and more I do this, the more I get comfortable with it. I mean, I'm a striker. That's who I am. You know, I wouldn't say I'm the best MMA fighter, but I'm working on it. I'm getting better every day, and you'll see me back in here very, very soon.
I'm sure we will. Let's take a look at some of your handiwork here. Just a beautiful combination that started it all off. The left and the right behind it dropped him. Tell us what's going through your mind when you see him go down.
When I see him go down, man, I know it just, I got to be careful because I see guys rush in, get hit, and get knocked out. So I'm very hesitant going in. I knew he wasn't getting back up, so I just tried to finish him from there, and it worked.
Well, Steven, it's been amazing watching you grow in your MMA career. I can't wait to see you again. Steven Thompson, ladies and gentlemen.
Big win for Steven Thompson. Very humble in victory as he wins for the fourth time in his UFC career. And I'll tell you what, you want to talk about an athlete. I mean, this kid's an athlete. How about this for a celebration? Don't try that at home. Wonder Boy. That's outstanding. Ah, Stone Cold Steve Austin here tonight. Watching UFC 1.
Wahlberger is a creative ground fighter who has submitted Mike Stumpf, J-Cact, and Nick Catone in the octagon. And after wins in three of his last five fights, the 25-year-old is starting to approach his fighting prime at the perfect time.
I have better timing. I feel like I'm faster and craftier on the ground.
Veteran Mike Quicksand Pyle has finished 16 of his 25 career wins by tap out. But three of his last four victories have seen him win by knockout over James Head, Josh Neer, and Ricardo Funch, proving that his fight game is even more dangerous than ever.
Tonight, I will beat TJ because I am an all-around better fighter.
The dark horse, TJ Wahlberger. Huge respect for Mike Pyle. And they both excel at the submission game. So tonight, what will we see? We might see the stand. Mike Pyle.
Ready.
TJ Wahlberger. Tonight's clock brought to you by Bud Light. Here we go. Pyle in the red and white trunks with the mullet. Black and white trunks for TJ Wahlberger. Nice leg kick. Pyle is very economical with his energy. He doesn't panic. It's like you talked about, Joe. He is a true veteran of this sport.
Well, he's just an excellent mixed martial arts fighter. He really knows everything there is to know about this game. Yeah.
And a great teacher, great coach, too. I mean, for years, he was the ultimate training partner and coach for a lot of the fighters at Extreme Couture, and then he got his shot and he's made the most of it. 8 wins in the UFC. Looking for number 9 tonight.
So far, a measured approach by both fighters, opening up with some leg kicks.
Talking about basics and timing.
Good inside leg kick by Pyle and good return by Wahlberger.
Pyle, many years. Oh, nice clinch.
Wahlbergers get the clinch. Dropping down, looking for a single. Pyle has outstanding takedown defense. Let's see if he can keep this very, very strong young kid in Wahlberger off of him. Very nicely done. And note how quickly he let go of that wizard and spun out of there. That's experience. Knowing that there was a little bit of an opening there. Wahlberger looking for a high kick, fell. That was pure knowledge and experience.
That's hundreds of hours in an MMA gym, right?
And hundreds of hours also against high-level competition in the gym. That was a good left hook there by Wahlberger. TJ went to it again. Got to be careful it doesn't go to that well too many times.
Mike Pyle was very honest about the Matt Brown fight. You know, some guys, I made a mistake, I got caught. He goes, I didn't make a mistake, I got caught. He punched me in the face, he knocked me out. Good job by him. I'm not going to let it happen again tonight. Mike just became a father.
There's a beautiful right hand over the top and then a left behind it by Wahlberg.
Nice kick.
Wahlberger's getting his confidence in the stand-up exchanges.
Pyle naming his son Maximus
Max Pot. Nice up the middle.
Went with the front kick there. Nice knee. And beautiful. Very well done. That's again the experience. The experience of Pyle. He's got to be careful of the guillotine though. TJ's trying to set up the guillotine. And Pyle very nicely hit his neck. Stays on top. Butterfly guard. TJ. He's got one hook on the right side. And he's going to try to elevate him. And he uses it to switch to the other side. And nicely done by Mike Pyle. Right into side control. That was beautiful. Just went with the momentum. And maintained excellent control. Now this is where TJ wanted this fight most likely. On the ground, but not this way. With Mike Pyle on top of him in a dominant position. Got a lot of time to work here. Stick right back up. Nicely done by TJ.
Wahlberger has gone to a decision just four times in 24 career fights.
There's that knee pile that he loves inside the clinch. He's looking for the Kimura on the right arm. There's that knee again. Mike's very crafty with those knees in the clinch.
Conditioning is excellent. He worked with Mike Dolce on his strength and conditioning, of course, his diet and the cut. Dolce, the best in the business.
There's that knee again. He's got that plump, got that Muay Thai clinch.
He catches one of those knees in the right spot, it could be good night, TJ Wahlberger. Good control by Pyle.
Well, good job of reversing too.
So you got through the round, right?
Breathe.
Deep breaths. Give me a couple deep breaths. How you feeling?
Good.
Here, this is your water. Okay, deep breaths. Very good. Mike, he's picking it up a little bit. When you're throwing those lazy kicks, he's winging them, right? You can't throw lazy shit because he's looking for home runs. That's right. If you're going to let your hands go, you let the fucking things go. I like your jab. Everything's going to work off the jab. Start fainting off the jab, hooking off the jab, right? Okay. And if you're going to throw a right hand, throw that fucking thing.
And there's a knee to the body and a beautiful trip by Mike Pyle. I like the way he mixed that up here. And here's the exchange. Pyle turned with the momentum of TJ and wound up on top.
Look at beautiful Lariani. The battle continues. Round two. Good use of the clinch, good use of the body lock in round one by Pyle. Throwing those knees that Joe talked about. Up the middle goes Wahlberg.
Solid jab there by Pyle.
TJ started his career early, Joe. He turned pro at age 17 when he was still in high school.
He started his career early if he started today.
Yeah, right?
Kid's only 25.
No kidding.
Nice head kick there. Blocked by Pyle.
25 and tonight, fight number 25 of his career. Mike Pyle, the story is, went to a Hoist Gracie seminar in Kentucky years ago. Mike's from Dresden, Tennessee. And he taught himself jiu-jitsu with videotapes and a mat dummy that he named Bob after attending the seminar.
Down. A kick, leg kick attempt by TJ. Pyle's leg is trapped here. Pyle's on top. Good control by Pyle. And there were some good leg kicks while you were talking that were being landed by TJ Wahlberg.
You can see the damage right there, Joe.
Yeah, Wahlberger landed two real solid right leg kicks. Pyle's got to get his neck out of there. He's in half guard, but you can still get in trouble in half guard. Okay, now the hands are broken.
You have two very experienced submission finishers.
And Mike's stepping over to try to mount, and TJ adjusts. And TJ goes for the neck again, but now Pyle slips past the knees and into side control. Pyle's going knee to belly here.
Nice, and he's out. Perfect technique.
But TJ used that moment to adjust and wind up in butterfly guard. But he's got to be careful as he stands up that Pyle doesn't catch him with the
and
knee.
There it is. Right on cue. Nice call.
Well, he's always looking for that. That's one of his signature techniques. He looks for guys to leave openings in transitions, and he capitalizes on those openings. And that's a lot of that is experience. Experience and knowledge and a deep understanding of MMA.
Throwing something going in, throwing something going out.
And there's a knee again. And I'd like to see Wahlberger get back to those leg kicks. He's really doing a good job with them, and he was landing them behind the punches, throwing them in combination, and then finishing up with a hard leg kick where the kicks were masked by the punch combinations.
Right. Spin.
Breaking it down, Mike. Take
your time. 2 minutes on the clock here in round two. The battle on the feet. Very even. Tonight's stats brought to you by Ram Trucks. Guts, glory, Ram.
There's that good left hook by TJ. Right over the right glove of Mike Pyle. Went to the body, to the head. You just got to be careful he doesn't get lazy in the clinch there with Pyle. Drops down for a single. Pyle locks onto a Kimura. And they get a bit of a stalemate here. And there's that knee attempt again by Pyle. There's some blood on his knee, so it connected somewhere.
Yeah.
Pyle's got double underhooks here. Let's see if he can take it down.
Yep.
And he's got his back. He's got to be careful. Got to be careful.
Oh, look at the transition.
Beautiful transition by Pyle. Look out for that arm. Look at this, TJ. Excellent on the ground. Right back up to his feet.
Well, we kind of knew coming in, Joe, that submission-wise, both these guys' skills were very even. And it's fun to watch the chess match that's taking place because of that.
Well, you know, both guys have great skills. You never really know if they're even until you see those skills pitted against each other. Right. We've been shocked before. There's that right hand over the top again by Wahlberger.
Wahlberger's bloodied up.
Yeah, I think that was that knee.
It's a knee. Yeah, one of those knees you talked about.
We saw the blood on the knee.
Yeah. Final seconds of the round.
TJ going to the body with that front kick. That front leg kick.
You are winning the stand-up, TJ. I know your shoulders are tired, but you got to keep them up. You're winning the stand-up. Okay? Keep it up. Get you a takedown if you can. Okay? You got to pummel if he gets those double unders. Okay? Look for your uppercuts and hooks when he tries to tie you up. Okay? If you'll stay outside of him, your striking's outdoing him right now. Okay?
There's a front kick right down the middle by Pyle.
That leg kick, Joe, was the example of using his hands to set it up you talked about.
Yeah, TJ was doing a good job of shielding the kick. And there's that knee. Wow, very nicely done by Pyle. He loves that knee in the clinch. He's very sneaky in how he delivers it.
Might have been that front kick that bloodied him up.
Could have been. There's a cut on the left eyebrow, and there's certainly some blood coming out of the nose as well.
All right, 5 minutes left. Anybody's fight. Mike Pyle, TJ Wahlberger. Battle at 170.
And there's again, nice jab and the right leg kick right behind it as Pyle reacts to the punch. TJ's done a good job of landing those techniques. Ooh, good combo there. And TJ goes down the front with the front kick.
It's ball. Go in. Go force it.
You hear TJ's corner asking him to not force it. You want him, there's again, nice one punch and then hard leg kick behind it. Ooh, good right hand by Pyle.
Nice boxing. Of course, Mike Pyle working here in Vegas with Jimmy Gifford on his striking.
Jimmy telling him in the corner to throw more jabs and to hook off the jab as well. He'd like to see that. TJ being very quick in this third round.
Giffey's a striking master when it comes to coaching.
Yeah, he's got a deep knowledge of boxing, that's for sure.
Good old Boston kid.
Yeah, and a great asset to a lot of MMA fighters that have trained with him. So far, we're definitely seeing improved. Oh, there's a nice right hand by Pyle. That may have hurt him. That was a nice clean right hand.
Right on
he hit him again. He hit him again. It's a little stumble to the step of TJ. And there's the takedown attempt because of it. And Pyle aware. Oh,
see the shoulder shot? Nicely done. That's a veteran move right there.
It certainly is. And a nice jab by TJ.
A little shoulder, boom, and then a shot again.
And there's that knee by Pyle right down the middle.
Pyle's striking looks clean here in the third round.
And before those right hands landed, I was going to say that I'm impressed with TJ. Oh!
Caught him with a spinning back.
There's a knee.
Watch out for another one. Got the clinch. Good elbow. Some dirty boxing here.
In the transitions, if TJ can't take him down here, this is when he's got to be careful, because that's where Pyle's a master at landing shots.
Jimmy Gifford, Mike Dolce in the corner, and Mike Pyle tonight.
Halfway, Mike.
There's a good knee by TJ.
Some damage done a moment ago.
Yeah, those are good clean punches by Pyle. There's a knee again. Oh, beautiful elbow. Beautiful elbows. Two in a row. He's hurt. He's hurt.
Oh,
there's a knee.
He walked right into that one.
Pyle looking for the guillotine.
Looking to finish this fight.
Oh,
can he get the submission?
It looks good. He's got the arm.
I did too. Herb Dean right on top of the action.
TJ is in big trouble here with a minute and a half to go. Pyle's got full back mount. Oh, this fight's over.
Trying to finish it right here.
Herb Dean should stop this fight.
It is all over! Mike Pyle finishes TJ Wahlberger!
You know, I'm a big fan of Herb Dean, but I think that was a bit of a late stoppage. The kid was just lying there.
It did look like for a second he was out on that one shot.
Well, I think he was, Mike, and I think he popped back to consciousness. That was a big, big win for Mike Pyle.
Fight replay brought to you by Bud Light. Here we go.
Man, and it was the right hands earlier in the round that started it off. But here's the end. He goes for the guillotine, uses it to mount him, and just couldn't quite keep his hands gripped underneath the chin. Realized that TJ got out of it. So, boom, lands one. Boom, and another. And TJ's in big trouble here, Mike. It looked like he was badly dazed. It's hard to tell because obviously he's on the ground, so we don't see his balance, but I think he's really hurt here. And here's the end of the fight. Another big elbow, and then raining punches. And Herb Dean takes a look at him. TJ's in big, big trouble here, and Herb Dean has seen enough. Big, big win for that man, Mike Pyle.
Great striking in round three.
Jimmy Gifford's going to be proud of Mike Pyle. Here is Bruce Buffer with the official decision.
Ladies and gentlemen, referee Herb Dean has called a stop to this contest at 4 minutes, 3 seconds of the third round, declaring the winner by TKO, Mike Quicksand-Pyle.
The winner, Mike Pyle. Mike, congratulations on another excellent victory over a very tough kid in TJ Wahlberger. It looked like it was a right hand that started off. You hurt him once with it, then he came after it again, and then finally, once you got him to the ground, caught him in that guillotine and used it to mount him, and that was all she wrote.
Yeah, well, you said it. I guess I don't have to say it, but yeah, he was tough. Hit me with some good shots. His leg kicks were pretty hard. I expected a battle, and that's what I got.
Was there anything surprising about this fight?
No, we prepared for him fully. He did just what we thought he would.
Well, let's take a look at the final sequence. You grabbed that guillotine, used it to mount him, and then once you got on top, when you had this guillotine, did you decide to let it go once you got to the mount?
No, he actually slipped out. Yeah, he slipped out, so I just continued to stay where I was at.
Were you surprised that Herb Dean didn't stop it sooner? It looked like he took a couple too many shots.
Well, he took a good hard look, but TJ was trying to get out of there. But when I flattened him out, that was it.
Mike, this is another big win for you. Give us your thoughts on what this means to you now.
Hey, well, they got me at number 15. Let's get in the top 10.
Well, I'd like to see that.
Thank you. Hey, real quick, World Fishing Network, let's go fishing.
Take Mike Pyle fishing, please. Congratulations, sir. Mike Pyle, ladies and gentlemen.
Ah, the best mullet in MMA. And a big win for Mike Pyle. And I'm sure little Maximus is happy. Will Smith and his beautiful family in attendance here tonight at UFC One Star was halted by the Ruthless One. So tonight, Rory McDonald fights Damian Maia as he looks to get back on track at 170 pounds.
In tonight's welterweight matchup between Damian Maia and Rory McDonald, fight fans will see one of the sport's greatest grapplers facing off against a young man believed to be the future of the division.
Tonight is the night I make my statement in the welterweight division. I think an impressive win over Damian tonight puts me in title contention.
It's impossible to get to the title shot if you don't fight tough fighters. And it will be a hard fight, you know, for me, but also a hard fight for him. So, you know, I don't care.
Former middleweight contender Damian Maia has found new life at 170 pounds, winning 3 of his 4 bouts since moving south in 2012. And his victories over Dongyoung Kim, Rick Story, and John Fitch have made it clear that the Brazilian is in his fighting prime.
Tonight, I will have the opportunity of my life. If I beat Rory, I know I'll be near to the title shot.
Canada's Rory McDonald has won 6 of his 8 UFC bouts. And with teammate George St. Pierre stepping away from the octagon, Eric is hungrier than ever to reach the top of the wide-open welterweight division.
I believe I could beat anybody in this division.
Ladies and gentlemen, this fight is 3 rounds in the UFC welterweight division. Introducing first, fighting out of the blue corner, a Brazilian jiu-jitsu fighter holding a professional record, 18 wins, 5 losses, standing 6 feet tall, weighing in at 170 pounds, fighting out of Sao Paulo, Brazil, Damian Maia! And now introducing his opponent, fighting out of the red corner, a boxer and jiu-jitsu fighter, holding a professional record, 15 wins, 2 losses. He stands 6 feet tall, weighing in at 171 pounds, fighting out of Montreal, Quebec, Canada, Rory Aaron McDonald. And when the action begins, our referee in charge, Yves Lavigne.
Yves Lavigne, our referee. There is Vanessa. We are set for a big welterweight matchup. Rory McDonald.
You ready, sir?
Damian Maia. Tonight's card brought to you by Bud Light. Here we go.
Immediately, Damian shoots.
And a good sprawl by Rory.
And Rory's got a nice low stance, Mike. Low stance, throwing hard shots, and a big sprawl. This isn't the Rory McDonald we saw in the Ellenberger fight. He's playing it safe. He got right into the lion's den, and now he's on the ground, one of the greatest submission artists in MMA today. The thing is, it's way easier to be defensive and to keep a guy off you than it is to catch a guy. If you got a guy who's good, like Rory, against a guy who's great, like Damian Maya, when it comes to jiu-jitsu, sometimes the good guy can do just enough as long as he doesn't attack and leave himself open to defend himself.
Damian Maya has earned 6 UFC victories by submission.
So far, good butterfly hook by Rory, making sure that Damian doesn't step over. He's switching it over to the left leg. That's interesting. That's high-level stuff. And let's see if he can elevate Damian and get his hips up. Damian doing a good job of adjusting. This is a bit of a chess battle here. Rory knows he's in a dangerous position. Anytime you're on the ground with Damian Maya, especially when both guys are dry, no one's all sweaty and slippery yet, it's easier for a guy to control you. Both guys are also at full strength. Damian about to pass over that leg, it looks like. And there's one leg over. He's almost mounted him here. He's got it. He's mounted him.
This is bad for Rory McDonald.
That's the difference between a guy like Damian Maya and most of the other people that he's going to face against. Good right hand by Maya.
Now, nice job done by Damian.
And it looked there for a bit like Maya was putting his left foot in between the legs of Rory, which might have been to bait Rory into turning to a side where that leg in the center would act then as a hook if he took the back.
5-time Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu world champion, Damian Maya.
With a guy like Damian Maya, he's setting things up 2 and 3 moves in advance. Roy's got to be very careful there as he bucks not to give up his back. And he does not like this one bit.
Nope.
He's trapped here, and he's trapped here with a far superior grappler. You see the right leg of Rory keeps trying to go over the top and hook the legs of Damian.
Look at this.
Almost
there.
No cigar. Here's a knuckle sandwich for your troubles. And Rory's almost out. And Rory's rolling. And Damian stays on top.
And adjusts nicely.
Adjusts nicely, but in half guard now. The left leg of Rory is in between the two of them and presents a bit of a barrier, makes it much harder for Damian to get power, and makes no submissions available from that spot.
You saw Rory wipe a little blood from under his eye.
Well, he's eating some shots, and Damian's going to step over that right leg and mount him again. Rory's aware of it, so he's looking to think about that leg, and while he's thinking about it, that's when Damian punches
him. Big round for Damian Maya.
Biding his time. Now Rory's got double butterfly guards, which is much better. He scoots him back, but Damian stays on top, maintaining control. And Damian will oftentimes step over one leg in order to bait him into going the other way. Staying on top, trying to slide that leg through. It's the left leg of Rory McDonald that's keeping him from being mounted.
It's a huge round for Damian Maya.
And Damian maintaining that leg in between. Rory hit him with a hard hammer fist there. Rory back up to his feet. Nicely done by Rory McDonald.
Nice sprawl.
And a good kick by Rory. Oh, nice leg kick.
Slip.
Damian was thinking about a spinning back fist there.
But Damian has improved his striking.
Improved, but it's not quite up to the level of Rory's.
No,
not at all. And left hook by Damian.
Right as you said that,
Damian.
Big, big combination. Very hard on his striking. Which is friendship and Vanderlei Silva, so that's a good place to start. Big round for Maya.
Big round.
You got to win part when you punch, okay? You're doing good. You did a good job. You weathered the storm. Breathe. Breathe. Win part position. Don't give him anything for free, okay? Breathe. It's all about exhaling now on your punches, Rory. exhale on your punches. Breathe. Now, you got to get a little lower. You got a bit underneath you in the first thing. You can weather the storm, okay? Close the guard. Don't need to open the guard. Now, just keep your head low. Sprawl them out like you did. When you sprawl them out, circle and detach. Don't let anything touch.
Here's a takedown by Damian Maya. He got that single and kept spinning with it. Went left and then went right. Note how he led him one way. And here's a nice right hand. He led him one way, and as Rory adjusted, he spun around behind him. And here's the left hand and then a right hand behind it by Damian Maya. Good shots by Damian Maya.
Step back a little bit. Step back. Thanks. Fight!
Damian Maya, Rory McDonald, round two. Round one to the Brazilian in a big way. Oh! He was just getting up as Rory threw that kick.
And the kicks are something that Damian Maya is not throwing. Rory is. It gives Rory a little bit more distance to strike from, but he's got to worry about his leg getting trapped and getting taken to the ground again by this grappling wizard. Good sprawl by Rory.
He had a couple good sprawls before, too. Just got caught that one time. And then it was Maya getting the full mount for a while.
Well, Maya is just so technical with his takedowns. I mean, anytime you're a Brazilian jiu-jitsu guy, you can take down a guy like Rick Story. Whoa. Big head kick.
Yeah, Maya's got to be careful.
Nice inside leg kick by Maya.
Rory trying to stay on.
Well, it's going to be much more difficult for Maya to take him down this round, both because he's a little more tired and also because Rory's slipperier. Big sprawl by Rory. Very nicely done. Good takedown defense.
Rory is an excellent athlete as well. Trains with Jonathan Chamber on his strength and conditioning at TriStar.
Rory's opening up with combinations. The more confident he gets in his takedown defense, the more he's able to put it on Damian Maya. Nice kick to the body. That
hurt him.
Maya's hurt.
Yeah, a couple of them have hurt him.
But that's really hurt. And Maya's going down the middle with that leg kick.
Maya's got to be careful.
Yeah, he's hitting him with that inside leg kick as Rory tries to go up high.
He's done some damage, you can see. Maya.
Yeah, he slowed down considerably.
With that one takedown, the eight others have been stuck.
And Maya's got to be really careful with these stand-up exchanges because his punches look like they're coming through slow motion. He can't just get into an ego battle here and exchange with Rory if he's not 100%. Like, look at his punches.
Yeah.
They're very slow now.
Oh, he's hurt.
Yeah. I believe he is.
And Rory's conditioning, as we mentioned, is excellent. He looks strong.
Well, you know, it's body kicks take a long time to recover from. And he might look like he's okay as he's moving around, but internally, he might feel terrible right now.
Oh,
there's a big kick by Rory.
Yeah. That's what they always say. Make him pay for the takedown attempts. Yeah,
Damian's in trouble.
Yeah, big time.
If Rory opens up on him right now, he might be able to put him away.
There's more kicks. Jonathan Chamberg works with a lot of athletes at TriStar and also a lot of hockey players. Want to send out a get well to Penguins All-Star defenseman Chris Letang, who I know is watching tonight. Chris, I hope you get better soon. Get back on the ice.
Damian seems to be recovered a bit now. Looking a little bit better. There's that inside leg kick again.
That won't help. 90 seconds.
Ooh, beautiful right hand by Rory.
Rory might stop this in this round, Joe.
Well, it looks like Damian's feeling better. He's moving a bit better now. Not looking like he's in slow motion like he did earlier after he was tagged by those shots. That's a much better left hand there. There's a big kick. There's that inside leg kick
caught him in the ribs. Maya with the answer. No head movement for Maya.
Well, Rory's the superior striker, and Maya's the superior grappler. And that's what we're seeing here.
And the jab is the trademark of TriStar.
Well, he's got an excellent one. Very long, penetrates with it. and throws it at different speeds.
Nobody covers distance with the jab like George St. Pierre. And they train together and under the same coaches.
There's that kick to the body again. And of course, as Maya goes for that inside leg kick every time Rory throws his kicks.
So as big a round one has Maya turned in, the second has belonged to the Canadian.
Yeah, it certainly has. And arguably, he's done more damage.
Yes. Final seconds.
Rory looks very comfortable out there in this round, Mike. Able to stuff every takedown attempt. There's that kick to the body again.
Big round for Rory McDonald.
Take off your mouthpiece. Attention, just breathe. Just recuperate. Let your heart rate go down. This fight's 1-1. He won this round. You gotta turn to your right. Don't go to your left. All he's trying to do is kick you to make you feel. You gotta move to your right. You gotta feint.
And here's the body kick by Rory McDonald. And this is one of the things we always talk about when we discuss the stances. The orthodox stance of Rory competing against the southpaw stance of Damian Maya. It opens up that body kick, and that's where we saw it. And you see, Damian keeps going for that inside leg kick. Not a lot of power behind it. He's throwing it almost up instead of across.
Rory has the second highest striking accuracy differential in welterweight history. Behind you-know-who. The longtime champion, GSP.
Well, Rory looks outstanding tonight in the striking. You can tell when he's looking to just box, though. When he's dropping his weight down, he's not leaving enough space for him to throw kicks. Now when he throws kicks, he stands straight up.
He has stuffed 11 of 12 takedown attempts.
Well, if Damian Maya is gonna take him down, he's gonna have to take him down when he's standing straighter. There's a kick again.
Damian got one and it lasted almost the entire first round, Joe. But he hasn't gotten another.
It's gonna be much harder now. As we said, they're very sweaty and slippery, and Damian's very tired, and he took a lot of punishment in that second round. Oh, beautiful straight right. And Rory's doing a very good job of measuring with that jab. And you start to see Damian Maya's face get busted up. Look at that easy stuff. And notice how he stuffed it. Listening to Firas Zahavi in the corner. As he sprawled and then turned out of it. He didn't allow Damian Maya to follow him.
He dedicated his life to MMA at age 14. Quit all other sports. He was so good at age 18. Sean Shelby, one of our matchmakers, tried to bring him into the WEC. He was ready at 18.
That's pretty incredible.
Yeah.
I would say it's a good decision to quit those other sports.
Yes.
All right, but now Damian has a hold of his single. Let's see if Rory can get out of this. Damian now with a double, though.
The crowds that we have at our shows, Joe, over the years have just, they've become true students of the game. You heard the reaction to the takedown. They understand it. And it makes it more fun for us.
Yeah, there's nothing to not understand here. Damian Maya wanted to get this fight to the ground. Now he's got it, but only 2 minutes and 30 seconds to work. Let's see if he can make something happen. Let's see if he can hold on to Rory McDonald.
Big first round for Damian Maya.
There's a lot of blood, Mike, and I'm not sure whose it is. I believe it's Damian's.
And a big second round for Rory McDonald.
Yeah, it's Damian's blood.
And now here in the third, Maya gets his second takedown in 14 attempts. Oh, my goodness!
Beautiful job by Rory McDonald.
Wow!
There's that jab.
Maia coming off a close split decision fight against Jake Shields, a five-rounder in Sao Paulo.
Another big sprawl. Nice right set of bodies. And another sprawl.
6-17 takedown attempts. Two have landed.
There's that front kick down the middle by Rory.
Rory's been sprawled and brawled tonight.
Yeah, he's looked angry and focused tonight, Mike. This is the Rory McDonald. Oh, he hurt him. This is the Rory McDonald that we love and shows so much potential.
The Rory McDonald who was beating Carlos Condit until that third round when the fight got stopped with 7 seconds remaining. 45. Damian's leaving everything he can, though, inside the octagon.
Rory's tagged him with that right.
Boom.
Oh!
Just missed with the big right hand.
I'll tell you what, Rory McDonald's been criticized in the past for fighting safe. He's not fighting safe tonight. He's fighting angry.
You know what he's fighting for? He's fighting for an opportunity to make a statement that when Lawler and Hendricks get done, he's waiting, and he's ready.
And there's a nice right hand. Oh! Beautiful combinations by Rory McDonald.
Great finish by Rory McDonald.
Wow. Outstanding
great heart
performance by
Damian
Rory
Maia.
McDonald.
I'd say that's the best he's looked, but here was the DS fight and the BJ Penn fight. He's well, looked good before.
Yeah, well.
But game plan-wise, outstanding tonight.
Yeah, against a guy like Damian Maia, to find yourself on your back, mounted in that first round with that beast on top of you. He survived, got back to his feet, and then the next two rounds with a Rory McDonald show. And you see on the face of Damian Maia, he knows he lost that fight. And he took a beating in the second and third rounds. Very tough, tough man, Damian Maia. He took some hard shots and kept coming forward. Never stopped trying to win the fight, but Rory McDonald showed superior striking tonight and outstanding takedown defense. Look at that nasty jab. And that's what started everything off, that beautiful jab. And here, Damian Maia got him down in the first round and was able to hold him there for the majority of the round. Really did an excellent job, mounted him, threatened him, and there's a nice straight right by Rory McDonald, and it was the body kicks that really had Damian Maia hurt, and there's a nice straight right hand. And here's the end of the fight. Rory McDonald just teeing off with combinations. Damian Maia never stopped trying to win that fight. Knowing there's only 10 seconds left, still shot in for a takedown. That's a warrior.
Our fight replay brought to you by Bud Light. Here we go. And with the official decision and our Metro PCS judges call, brought to you by Metro PCS, where nationwide 4G LTE is $40, period. Here is Bruce Buffer.
Ladies and gentlemen, after three rounds, we go to the judges' scorecards for a decision. All three judges score the contest, 29-28. For the winner, by unanimous decision, Rory Aries McDonald.
Big win for Rory McDonald over Damian Maia.
I'm here with the winner, Rory McDonald. Rory, congratulations on a really spectacular performance. The first round, he got you down. He got on top of you. Obviously, that wasn't the game plan. What was going through your mind then?
Well, just to stay calm. You know, I think if I overreacted and got stressed out against a guy of his caliber, it wouldn't take too long for him to put me away, tire me out. So,
Rory, you showed really great striking tonight, great takedown defense, but more importantly, you were very aggressive tonight. Did you want to make a statement here tonight with this performance?
Yeah, you know, the animal is back. I'm ready to kick some ass. You know, I'm ready to kill. You know, I have my mindset back in track. I'm ready for that title.
Well, you're still a very young man with a huge future in this game, and that was an outstanding performance tonight. Congratulations, and I can't wait to see you get after it. Good luck. Rory McDonald, ladies and gentlemen.
Congratulations to Rory McDonald. He earns the victory and puts himself right back in position for a shot at the title. For Asahabi, Jonathan Chamberg, great job by Rory. Sunday, March 9th, exclusively on UFC Fight Pass, the first episode of the Ultimate
Fight for Daniel Cormier. This is the first fight Daniel Cormier is dropping down to 205 pounds.
I'm going
to
be at 205 next fight. I'm going to be the champion eventually. Those guys can't get away from me for long.
As I lost weight, I'm faster, my endurance is better, and I'm able to put more energy into my training.
And now he's shed all this weight, and I think it's definitely going to take a toll on him.
Patrick Cummins was a two-time NCAA All-American. He's undefeated in mixed martial arts. He's 4-0, and every one of his four fights were finishes.
His striking is very strong. He's got great kicks. He's always in shape, outstanding conditioning, and a real freak athlete. I have seen Pat Cummins dominate UFC fighters at the gym. I'm talking about guys headlining fights, and Pat Cummins rolls through them.
Patrick Cummins. Pat, when I was getting ready for the Olympic Games in 2004, he was one of my training partners.
This kid Cummins claims that he would make Cormier cry, and he says, I would break him every time we wrestled, and I'm gonna break him on Saturday night in this fight.
I don't think he can deny it. He knows in his head that's what happened. I'm going to be in his face from the start, and I don't think he can keep up. He's good for 5 minutes of a hard push, and he's going to sit back in that chair at the end of the round and just be like, oh, no, what have I done?
Taking the fight is probably the biggest mistake Pat Cummins has ever made in his entire life, because not only did he take a fight with me on 10 days notice, he opened his mouth. He really did open up a can, something that I left back in 2004. Something that I don't think about very much. So by opening that can, he won't like what's inside. I want to dominate Pat Cummins. I want him to feel helpless in every aspect.
Oh, he hurt him!
So far, Pat Cummins makes an excellent move with his walkout music.
You know what? He was a training partner on the U.S. national team of Daniel Cormier's in 2004. That's where the alleged beating took place. But in wrestling, in 2007, they fought real. Cormier won that match. A walk-on at Penn State, he turns out to be a two-time All-American and a two-time U.S. national team member. He wrestled heavyweight at Penn State, and he was the 2004 NCAA runner-up. So we mentioned about Mark Munoz. Mark Munoz said, this dude's for real. You know he is for real, but 10 days notice, Daniel Cormier, UFC, bright lights, all the press is on you because you were the one who got the phone call at the coffee shop. What really is going to happen when Pat Cummins walks through that gate?
We're about to find out.
Yep.
I'll tell you what, Pat Cummins belongs to the UFC. Pat Cummins would be an exciting entrant into the UFC no matter who he's fighting, but this is a tall order. It's a tall order, a dangerous proposition, and he has really pissed off Daniel Cormier. Let's see if that plays against Cormier or if he uses it as fuel to put a beating on this guy and punish him for his words.
Patrick Cummins from Doylestown, Pennsylvania, set to make his UFC debut in our co-main event of the evening.
Out of the red corner, a wrestler and a kickboxer, holding a perfect professional record, 13 wins, no losses. He stands 5 feet 11 inches tall, weighing in at 205 pounds. Fighting out of San Jose, California, he is the former Strikeforce heavyweight Grand Prix champion, Daniel D.C. Cormier! action begins. Our referee in charge, Mario Yamasaki.
Mario Yamasaki, our referee, for our co-main event of the evening. Daniel Cormier.
Here you go, first round, you ready?
Patrick
you
Cummins. Ready?
Let's go, come on.
Tonight's clock brought to you by Bud Light. Here we go. Black trunks for Cormier, blue trunks for Cummins.
Cummins has very good kicks, especially his left switch. Good boxing, excellent conditioning, and good transitions off the clinch.
Chael Sonnen said he is a bad dude. Called him the best unsigned talent in MMA.
I would agree with that. And it's because he hasn't been able to get fights. He hasn't been able to prove himself. And a guy like Chael knows, oh, he's hurt. He's hurt. He got tagged with that uppercut. Cormier tagged him. Nice inside leg kick.
And he said there's a big difference in wanting and needing to win. Cormier, first fight at 205.
There's also a big difference between a guy who's fought Josh Barnett and Bigfoot Silva and a guy who's fought four people no one's ever heard of.
Yeah. Cormier
keeps him again. He's hurt.
Cormier is hitting the uppercut. Looking to finish the fight. He's in trouble.
Cummins is in all sorts of trouble.
Friends, was a big message.
That's called payback.
Yes, it is.
It's the hands and the striking of Daniel Cormier. What we had said, it separates him from a lot of other wrestlers.
It also says what goes on in the wrestling room stays in the wrestling room.
That was Daniel Cormier, I believe, at his finest. That's right up there with the Bigfoot Silva knockout. Just spectacular hand technique by Daniel Cormier. He tagged him early with a right hand, had him hurt, kept the pressure on, didn't lose his composure, didn't get overexcited, but kept the pressure on with beautiful combinations. And let's look at this uppercut that starts it off. Clips him with that uppercut, tagged him. Now, I believe this is after he'd already been hurt.
That's a good one right there.
Yeah, this is towards the end. But he attacked him with several punches before that. And just Daniel Cormier in the finest form we've ever seen inside the octagon. And at 205, you want to talk about a threat? Daniel Cormier may be the threat.
Fight replay brought to you by Bud Light. Here we go. And here is Bruce Buffer.
Ladies and gentlemen, referee Mario Yamasaki has called a stop to this contest at 1 minute, 19 seconds of the very first round, declaring the winner by TKO, Daniel D.C. Cormier.
1:19 is all it took.
I am here with the winner, Daniel Cormier. First of all, Daniel, congratulations on a successful light heavyweight debut. Was this victory all the more sweet because of all the stuff that Pat had said leading up to this fight?
Yes, it had to happen this way. He could not have went the distance. I'm mad that he even hit me twice because of all the talking he did.
Well, you put on a show tonight, and this is probably your finest performance inside the octagon. Let's take a look at the beautiful striking technique you displayed in this fight. You had him tagged early, and you kept your composure and just kept the pressure on him. Just absolutely dominated this fight. Give me your thoughts now after it's all over when you're watching this.
Oh, it feels good, man. Listen, when you talk, you got to be able to back it up. That's what I do. Pat Cummins has a bright future in the UFC, but it was a big challenge for him. But you know what, man? I feel good about my first time down.
Well, this was a huge victory and a big statement for everybody else at 205. Give us your thoughts on the upcoming light heavyweight contest between Glover Teixeira and Jon Jones and where you fit in the light heavyweight division.
Let me tell you something, man. I fit right at the top, and if either of those guys get hurt, just insert me into that lineup.
Daniel Cormier, ladies and gentlemen, give it up.
Performance by Daniel Cormier in his light heavyweight debut, and his training partner, Cain Velasquez, with a big smile on his face. for the performance turned in by his buddy DC. Mercedes Lewis also in the house, watching the great action. Tight end for the Jacksonville Jaguars and a huge fan of the Ultimate Fighting.
And now it's time for our main event of the evening. Five rounds of fighting in the UFC Women's Bantamweight Division as Ronda Rousey battles Sarah McMahon.
As we mentioned at the top of the show, all the great athletes in Sochi, we have an Olympic showdown of Olympic medalists for the first time ever in UFC history. The wrestler, the judoka, but you just noticed the shot of Sarah McMahon, and you tap me, you go, she hits hard.
She hits real hard, and she's strong, and this fight may very well turn into two grapplers canceling each other out and duking it out on the feet.
Well, Edmund told me, Ronda Rousey's trainer, that they've been working her footwork for 2 years, and now in training, in her boxing, she is literally throwing liver punches and folding world champions. Her boxing has gotten that good.
I'm not surprised. Ronda Rousey gets great at anything she sets her mind to. This is a real epic contest we have in front of us tonight, and I can't wait to watch it. Yeah. Let's get after it.
Absolutely. Women's bantamweight rankings, of course, the champion, the only champion in UFC history in the women's bantamweight division, Rowdy Ronda Rousey. Kat Zingano, get healthy soon. Misha Tate had a chance. Alexis Davis, outstanding tonight. Sarah McMahon is 7-0.
Sarah McMahon is also an Olympic silver medalist and arguably one of the most talented wrestlers to ever compete inside the octagon. This is a real epic contest, Mike. A real excellent threat to Ronda Rousey's title.
All right, this will be the first time that she has met another Olympian. This will be an opportunity for Ronda to defend her title for the third time, but Sarah McMahon thinks that will not happen.
My entire career is either people absolutely love me or they couldn't stand me.
Ronda Rousey plays for keeps. She doesn't care what you think of her. She's not trying to earn PR points. She's not trying to get you to like her.
It is all over.
She taps. Wow. She went to shake Ronda's hand and Ronda walked away from her.
I like being the heel. I have the belt. And nobody really wants me to stay on top. That's why it's harder to remain the champion than to become the champion. And that's why I feel like I'm perfect for the job.
What you're going to get with Ronda Rousey versus Sarah McMahon is two elite athletes in their prime. It's a fantastic matchup for Ronda Rousey's bantamweight title, and I think that Sarah McMahon is a real threat.
Sarah got this shot because she's undefeated in MMA and she has an Olympic medal. We're both undefeated Olympic medalists, but this isn't the Olympics.
To beat a champion, you have to beat them everywhere.
For the bantamweight title, our tale of the tape is brought to you by Bud Light. Here we go. The champion is 27. The challenger is 33. Everything else is virtually identical. Once again, the veteran voice of the octagon, Bruce Buffer.
Ladies and gentlemen, this is the event of the evening, presented by Bud Light. Here we go. Sanctioned by the Nevada State Athletic Commission, with Chairman Francisco Aguilar, Commissioners Skip Evansino, Bill Brady, and TJ Day. Our three judges scoring this contest at Octagon Side are Chris Lee, Junichiro Camicho, and Glenn Trowbridge. And when the action begins, our referee in charge, Herb Dean. This bout is sponsored by Bud Light. Here we go. Powered by Ram Trucks, Guts, Glory, Ram, and Metro PCS, where nationwide 4G LTE is $40, period. And now, this is the moment UFC fans around the world have been waiting for. Live from the Mandalay Bay Resort and Casino in Las Vegas, it's time! Five rounds for the undisputed Women's Bantamweight Championship of the world. Introducing first, fighting out of the blue corner, a wrestler holding a perfect professional record, 7 wins, no losses. She stands 5 feet 6 inches tall, weighing in at 135 pounds. Fighting out of Gaffney, South Carolina, presenting the challenger, Sarah McMahon! And now introducing the champion, fighting out of the red corner. She is a judo fighter, holding a permanent professional record, 8 wins, no losses. She stands 5 feet 7 inches tall, weighing in at 135 pounds. Fighting out of Venice, California, presenting the reigning, defending, undisputed UFC Women's Bantamweight Champion of the World, Ronda Rousey!
All right, ladies, we've been over the rules. Protect yourself at all times. Follow my instructions. We're going to have a clean fight. Touch gloves now and come out and do this.
Ronda's got the badass stare and strut down better than anybody.
She's got the best mean face in the business.
Absolutely.
It's right up there with Vandalina's prime.
And Diego Sanchez.
Yeah, the female version of it.
Right?
That's an angry face.
This is awesome.
Here we go.
Rousey McMahon. Here we go. Caught you by Bud Light. Here we go.
Ronda got tagged. She got tagged.
That's that power of Sarah McMahon you talked about.
And good boxing technique as well. Not just power. She hit her again.
And again.
And Ronda's clinching up.
Good knees. Edmund told me that Ronda's boxing is really advanced. And you see some good shots there. The judoka and the wrestler are swinging, having a Muay Thai fight.
Attacking with knees to the body.
Watch out. Trying to set up a ride.
But note Sarah McMahon's weight low.
Yep.
She drops her weight below the hips. That most of the mistakes that Misha Tate made. She allowed her weight to get above Ronda's hips and she went flying. Sarah's not having any of that. But Ronda lands a nasty elbow in the clinch here.
And again.
Looking
to finish it. It is all over.
It was Ronda
Rousey with a vicious knee to the body to beat Sarah McMahon.
Wow. Wow. It was a knee to the liver.
Yep. And what did we talk about before? Liver shots is what Edmund was talking about. That time a knee.
Let's take a look at it again. Yup, right there. She hit her once. And there it is again.
Then a big one.
There's a nice elbow. This is not the exchange that stopped the fight. There it is. There's the liver shot that hurt her.
Fight replay brought to you by Bud Light.
She was trying to get up. People thought that it was a bit premature. She was trying to get up, but she was clearly down and hurt. Let's see it again. There's one. Yup, she drops. She's hurt. And it might have been a bit premature, but you got to give her a chance. You know, she was hurt. She went down. Herb Dean had a better look at it than us. If he thought she was done. You know, dropping like that and not defending yourself is not a good sign.
And Joe, when you take a liver shot like that, your body shuts down.
It literally does. I've been hit like that before. It sucks hard. And she got obviously hit on the button. Her body went limp. She went down. And Herb Dean decided he wanted to see her take any more punishment.
Ronda Rousey wins for the first time in her MMA career, not by armbar. Here's Bruce Buffer.
Ladies and gentlemen, referee Herb Dean has called a stop to this contest at 1 minute, 6 seconds of the very first round. Declaring the winner by TKO and still the undisputed UFC Women's Bantamweight Champion of the World, Rowdy!
She showcased some new skills tonight.
All right, I'm here with the champ, Ronda Rousey. First of all, Ronda, congratulations on an excellent victory against a very, very durable and tough opponent in Sarah McMahon. What was the game plan coming in here tonight, and what, if anything, surprised you?
We studied her videos, and we noticed no one ever really tried to hit her to the body. And since she's a wrestler, she has that bent posture. We felt like it was the best thing to really concentrate on the liver shot for this camp.
Let's take a look at the big screen, and this is the knee that put her down. You guys were battling in the clinch. You'd hit her with one good knee to the liver, caught her with a nice elbow, but there was one that you landed that just shut her down. When you saw her drop, tell me what was going through your mind when you saw the knee land and you saw her give out.
The left knee is what's been working for me the most during sparring this whole camp, and so I just thought as long as I stay consistent to that one spot, it'll eventually work.
Do you think there's ever going to be a time where I interview you where you don't hear boos like this?
It's better, because if the person next to you is booing, you want to cheer, then you both want to cheer louder than the other one, so it gets even louder in here. So thank you for the emotion, guys.
Well, listen, you did exactly what you had to do. Congratulations defending your title, and I can't wait to see you fight again.
I just want to thank all my friends, my teammates, my family. I love all you guys so much. I can't name everyone for name, but I appreciate you, and I'll see you in a second.
The champ, ladies and gentlemen, Ronda Rousey.
Ronda Rousey, 9-0, fastest knockout in women's bantamweight history. Here's Sarah McMahon.
All right, I'm here with Sarah McMahon. Sarah, give us your thoughts on the fight, and give us your thoughts on the stoppage.
I thought it was a good fight, you know. I got hit in the liver, and no matter how hard you train, it's not like you can get your liver stronger. So, I just look forward to going back to the drawing board. I hope to get a rematch and come back in here and put on a better fight.
Were you surprised that Herb stopped it? Did you think it was a just stoppage?
I was trying to get back up, but, you know, like, it's my own fault. If you see a fighter drop, then, you know, he's got to protect us. So I should have got back to my feet quicker.
What was your game plan coming into the fight, and what, if anything, surprised you?
Strike and control the ties, control her body and where the fight went. And I should have got off the cage a little bit quicker, and that would have kept me from getting kneed.
Well, Sarah, you are an excellent fighter. It's always a pleasure watching you perform. You are very gracious in defeat, and I look forward to seeing you perform again. Thank you very much. Sarah McMahon, ladies and gentlemen.
Disappointment indeed for Sarah McMahon. But we've seen those shots to the body buckle great fighters in the past, and that's what happened with Sarah. The body shuts down, and you can't do anything. You know, there's shots like Stephen Bonner when he got hit by Anderson Silva. Chael Sonnen with the knee to the body. There are just certain areas in your body that just buckle you, and you go into shutdown mode. And that's what happened. And Edmund had told me, as I said to you, Joe, that Ronda was really working on the liver shots, and she was folding world champions with her boxing. She did it with the knee, but she did exactly what was talked about, the liver shot.
Yeah, and she even said in the interview, obviously, that the left knee of the body had been working for her in training. She didn't just land one either. She landed several. And you saw that it was almost more, it was liver and maybe even solar plexus as well in there. I mean, that was a hard shot. No, it's right there on the button. And you see Sarah's body just go limp. It's almost impossible to stop. When you get hit hard like that, your body just doesn't work. And there's nothing you can do about that. Sarah McMahon is as tough as they come, and we'll see her again. But what we found tonight was that Ronda Rousey, when she can't judo toss you, she can't take you down, even if she can't box with you,